afternoon, ma'am.
How you been doing?
Oh, the school.
Got your pumpkin?
Good job.
Hello, so it is Tuesday at 6 o'clock in the evening, and I've actually just woken up from about an hour plus long nap. Reading wise, I finished The Warden today. Actually, I got home and, you know, needed a nap, and there was only like 10 minutes left of The Warden, and so I just laid on the couch and listened to the ending of it, and then took a nap right afterwards, and it was so good. And then right when I woke up from the nap, I turned on BookTube and I watched Natalie of My Reading Days had this whole video about discovering Anthony Trollope through reading The Warden, which she had a bit of a difficult start with it. And I did too. She was reading the physical copy of it. I was listening to the audiobook of it. And so whereas she was having having difficulty with some of these really long, complex sentences, I was reading the audio, or I was listening to the audiobook. So I didn't notice punctuation, but I was having a really difficult time getting into it as well because of just there's so many characters. And once again, it's one of these books where you have characters go by multiple names. So trying to understand that Mr. Harding is the warden, that the son-in-law is the archbishop, that the bishop is the archbishop's father, understanding all of these things really helps understand the novel. And so for me, I think that listening to the audiobook made it more of a challenge, but ultimately I really love The Warden. And I was so, even when I was still struggling as far as figuring out who was who, I was still really invested in the warden himself and the kind of quagmire he was in the middle of. So that was exciting to see, you know, Natalie just gushing about him and excited about reading more from him. I'm tempted to continue straight on with Barchester Towers, which is the second book in the Chronicles of Barsetshire series of Trollope's. But I'm still reading Wuthering Heights, which I'm really enjoying. I think I'm like 60% maybe through. So I'm going to get on to that. And then I have I'm about a quarter of the way through My Name is Monster for Spookathon, and she still hasn't encountered anyone yet. So she has come to a village, or like a town, and she's kind of holed up in a house or something like that at the moment. And I really don't know where this is going. So I'm enjoying what I'm reading, but I just hope this is going somewhere, basically. So I kind of don't know what to think yet. I'm enjoying what I've read so far. We're starting to get little inklings more about what happened, and pretty sure there's no zombies. I'm pretty sure that the sickness with the capital S was actually distributed via these bombs by, I guess, the government. And so I imagine that we'll be getting more about that story and what happened. She used to work in a seed vault. And so, you know, I want to understand more about why was a seed vault necessary? Who ran the seed vault? What was the purpose of it? Will she be able to get back to the seed vault and replant and, you know, be able to establish life again? And will there be other humans to share this with? I don't know. So many questions. I'm blathering on instead of actually just shutting up and reading. So I'm going to do that now. So I don't know if I don't think I mentioned this before, but I have suspected kind of from the beginning that Mother, formerly Monster, is on the autism spectrum, and it's never called that, but a lot of the ways that she is described and the way things that she says that her parents would say to her about her when she was young has made me think of that. And now we're seeing Mother through young Monster's eyes, and this is what Monster has to say about Mother. Mother isn't very good at looking at things. I don't mean like when I screw up my eyes and all the things in front of me lose their shapes. What I mean is, Mother isn't very good at understanding the things she's looking at. Sometimes she doesn't understand so hard. I think she wants the world to be empty. But the world isn't empty. This is something I know, and Mother doesn't know, that the world is full. So it's really interesting to see, just to see Monster's perspective of Mother now, and how, although Monster is not educated in the same way that Mother was, Monster has a perceptive ability that it seems that Mother is not capable of. So, just an interesting little tidbit there. So, an interesting note about Mother, formerly Monster, is that as she has become the mother of Monster, that aversion that she had to relationships and to people before is gone, and she really has come to depend on having Monster there and having Monster depend on her, taking care of her, and there's really a sweet relationship there with her, and there's a moment where she thinks Monster is gone, and she realizes, like, what was it like? What was it like before her? And it made me think about when my oldest niece was born. She's 9. She'll be 10 in January. And, you know, when she was a few weeks old, I remember us, my sister, my brother-in-law, my parents, we were watching Lost. We were watching Lost back then. And we were all hanging out and probably watching the baby, feeding the baby, passing her around or whatever. And just thinking, what did we do before her? And so, you know, for anyone who has kids or who has kids who they are very close to, it's a lot like that. Like, what did we talk about before there were kids? And so for the original Monster, who is now Mother, it's like pre-mother, post-mother, you know, transition from Monster to Mother, and now that she gets to be a mother to her own Monster, it's a really great, character development to see in her. And then now that we're in Monster's point of view, young Monster's point of view, we're getting to see Mother through her eyes, so really cool stuff. Good evening. It's 7 o'clock on Wednesday night. Had the kids today, and even though I wasn't feeling super great today, the baby was great, and she took two long naps and or long nap plus quiet playtime. I've just been watching some. So one of my favorite things to do, I give my husband haircuts, and I've been cutting his hair for years. You know, he was a Marine, and so a good haircut is important to him, and it's important to me too. And I love to watch barbering videos. So particularly, there's a men's hair styling company called Beard Brand, and they have all these barbering videos where there's, you know, a barber that they think is good, and they will, you know, just videotape them giving a haircut, and it's a little bit instructional, it's a little bit, you know, just fun conversation, and it is so satisfying and relaxing to me. And so it's become my thing lately when the kids leave for the day, and they're not like wild kids by any means, they're so well behaved, but just that little bit of like, the kids are gone and it's quiet and it's just me and the dog, and I watch a beard brand video or two. So I have just done that, and now I'm going to read. So if you want to know pretty much nothing about My Name is Monster, skip ahead a little bit. Previously when we spoke, not much had happened in terms of what Monster had encountered. She was the only person. She's just surviving on her own at this point, trickling in his information about what had happened to the world. There was the war and the sickness and something about a seed vault, and she had been working there. And so she had, I think the last thing I had mentioned is she'd kind of established this farmhouse as a home base, and it was near a city where she was able to go in and kind of look for any sort of supplies and provisions that she could. And she ends up encountering inside of this shop like a young feral girl, and she seemingly has no language, and Monster names the girl Monster, and she is Mother. So, you know, you Monster, me Mother. And so she teaches her language, and they become almost like a mother-daughter pair, kind of. And so we went through a certain point, and it's, you know, I guess years have passed at this point. Monster is now referring to the girl, not to the original character of Monster, but now the second generation Monster. She has begun puberty. As far as we know, they are the only surviving humans on the Earth. I've just entered part two of the book, which is, I'm over halfway. I'm like two-thirds maybe of the way through, and the perspective has just switched to young Monster's perspective rather than Mother's perspective. And so we're hearing a bit about her backstory and what seems to be her original mother that she has only one very specific haunting memory of, and that's her own private thing that she doesn't want to share with Mother. So I'm super digging this right now. I have 100... I have like 120 pages or so left in this book. I might see if I can finish it. So it's told in these really short... see if you can see this. So it's not quite chapters. It's like little subjects, basically. And so there's a lot of empty space on the pages. And so it goes really quickly when you're reading it. So there's usually only... the emotional encounter is like 4 or 5 pages of solid text before you get to a break. So maybe if I stop talking, I will be able to finish that tonight. I am 3/4 or so the way through Wuthering Heights. I'm on page 228 of 337. So about 110 pages left in this. Which you won't go as quickly as My Name is Monster. So I feel like I just want to power through and finish My Name is Monster so I can move on to another spookathon.
Good evening. It is Thursday evening, about 6 o'clock, and I am home for the day. I've done a little bit of chores, housework, and I am about to do a bit of a writing session, and then I will get back to reading. So this morning I finished off My Name is Monster by Katie Hale. I really enjoyed this book. This is one where if you are the type of reader that needs everything answered and every possible trail explored, this is not the book for you. It would probably really drive you crazy, as there are lots of little like tributaries that are kind of peeked at, but we don't get resolution. So what I found most interesting in this book was the look at language and connection and the power that language has. So when Monster finds the young feral girl, who then she names Monster and calls herself Mother from then on, Mother really kind of holds the cards because she's the one with language. And so she then is teaching Monster what she needs to know based on their environment, based on the world around them, and the words basically that she would need to know that they would encounter in their life. And so I found it so interesting when we went into Young Monster's point of view. And first of all, it's a bit of a... Dog wants in. Hang on. So part one is told first person from the original monster who then becomes Mother. Part two is told from Young Monster's perspective, first person perspective. And they have very different personalities, and therefore kind of their narrative is told differently. So Mother, who starts off as Monster, is much more cut and dry and to the point. And Young Monster is very perceptive, very introspective, very curious about the world, and the way that, based on the limited language that she has and knowledge that she has, because she was so young at the time when the world really changed, is just so curious and interesting to, hi buddy, to see the world through her eyes and then also see Mother through her eyes. And she, for example, asks, you know, what do their names mean? What does Mother mean? What does Monster mean? And she says that Mother means creator and Monster means survivor. And so Young Monster really takes hold of that, and it keeps coming back to her throughout. And, you know, there are little snippets of memory, or just not even memory, but like notions that she has from the world previously that she doesn't even know how she knows something like that. Like, for example, of the sea, but she does know it. So it was, I found it really interesting the way that these words, this language interplayed with the relationship with the environment and the relationships with each other. And a really fun example was at one point, Mother is very upset with Monster and she calls her the B word. But she doesn't, Young Monster doesn't have any reference, point of reference for that word, but it sounds like bridge to her. So then she's like, bridge, bridges separate people. And then she's like, I don't want to be a bridge. I don't want us to separate. I want Mother and I always to be together. And so this concept of being, of bridges and separating versus being together continues on through the book. And what's funny is when I thought of bridge, I think of a bridge that connects people or places, not that divides. So, yeah, just a lot of really interesting wordplay and language. And I have a degree in speech-language pathology, so language in and of itself I think is quite interesting, and I like the way that it was handled in this. There was a particular direction kind of that this could have gone in that it's kind of a secret that Monster is keeping from Mother, and I really wanted that to be explored a little bit, but there's also kind of a sweetness in it not being explored as well. So, yeah, I think this is like a 4-star book for me. I think it's one I might, you know, I'm calling it 4 stars for now, and I'll see if I feel any differently down the road. So that one is finished. So that's my first Spookathon book complete, you know, a book with a spooky word in the title. And then also kind of a bit of a spooky spooky book based on the location is Wuthering Heights. So I am on page 229 out of 330-ish. So I probably am not going to be able to finish this tonight, but I'll see how far I get, because really my only plans is to write a bit and then read this. So let me talk about the writing a bit here. So I know I have a handful of new subscribers. Thank you for joining me. And for those who don't know, already know, my husband Sam was injured in Iraq. He's a Marine. He was hit by a roadside bomb in 2007. And he has a very severe traumatic brain injury, and he lives at a rehab home about 15 to 20 minutes away from me. He needs 24-hour nursing care, and he receives physical, occupational, speech, and music therapy. And he has basically no short-term memory. He remembers me, and he remembers things prior to his injury, although his long-term memory is kind of on a sliding scale. A lot of times he actually thinks that we're still in high school, as we were high school sweethearts. And I can usually jog his memory based on certain things, kind of like a timeline, up to about a little while before his last deployment where he ended up getting injured. He doesn't usually remember that he went to Iraq for a second time. So for years, his injury was 12 years ago, by the way. For years, people have been telling me that I should write a book, and I have finally decided to write a memoir. I have started it, and I plan to do it in a series kind of vignettes, a series of stories making up our overall story, and I'm actually able to get some input from Sam. So his ability to speak, and particularly his ability to be understood when he's speaking, is quite variable. It changes from day to day. It will even change within a day. So I really try to take advantages of those days when he is speaking quite well. And today was one of those days. And so although I wasn't writing at the time, we had a few moments before we got into a therapy activity that I was telling him, reminding him about the memoir and asking him, what do you think is an important thing in our life that we should talk about in the book? And he said, our wedding. So I asked him, I was able to ask him, how were you feeling before the wedding? Were you like anxious about it? Were you unsure about it? Were you like relieved? Like, how did you feel? And so he was able to give me his thoughts on that. What did he say? Okay, the notes are on my phone, which I'm recording off of because I didn't have anything to write down. So I just wrote it in my notes. He said he was relieved to get the let's do it hat off. And like, basically he was saying that he wanted to get married and he kind of wanted to just be married, to get it over with, not in the sense that it wasn't something he wanted to do, but to get it over with in the sense that he couldn't wait to be married. And so he wanted to get the let's do it hat off and to wear the I'm married to Aaron hat. So I'm not sure where this notion of hats came from, but when he first said the let's do it hat, I'm like, what do you mean? And he reaches up and he's like touching his head like a hat. I need more, but anyhow, so I think I'm going to write about kind of, from my perspective, the experience of our wedding day, and then I will get back to Wuthering Heights. Fortunately, our relationship is much better than anybody's in this book. Linton is such a whiny little twerp. Run away, Kathy. Run away.
Hey. Are you going to take a 6-hour nap at the Thinkies again today? Don't you love it when nature won't let you do any work? I mean, I have 8 fritillaries. I saw Mara this morning. And way down here, there's a painted lady now, so...
Good morning. It is Friday morning. It is about 6:45. It's like first light outside. So whatever I'm about to tell you I'm going to do, I'm probably going to have to pause within the next half hour to walk the dog. But I got quite far in Wuthering Heights last night, and I have, I think, exactly 50 pages to go. So I would love to be able to finish that this morning before I leave the house. I had a thought a little while ago before I started recording, and now I can't remember. So we're basically to a point where, from the very beginning of the story, we know that Heathcliff is the father-in-law of Kathy. And so now we're getting to the point where she will marry, it has to be Linton, and it's looking like it's going to be Linton because that's who she's been having a relationship with. And he is such just a whiny, selfish little twat. He's had a rough go at life, but he's not handled it well. I'm really interested to know, like, what is his actual illness, especially in Victorian literature. There's all these illnesses, maladies that people have that I always wonder, like, what's the actual diagnosis of this? I would probably have maybe more sympathy for him if I knew what it is that the Linton is suffering from, other than being a selfish twat. So, you know, I'm pretty sure Kathy is going to end up marrying him. And that sucks for her. So anyway, I'm making on with finishing this book, and the dog is ready to play. He just brought me a bone. The sun's not even up yet. So I'm at a point where Kathy is now living at Wuthering Heights, and the story is being told by Zyla, the housekeeper of Wuthering Heights, to Nellie, the housekeeper of Thrustcross Grange. And so the character of Kathy is now being told from a different perspective, and therefore her character has kind of changed. So it's just interesting, the unreliable narrators here, and how we have a different perception of Kathy's character based on kind of the biases of the housekeeper, either the housekeeper who loved her and raised her versus the housekeeper who, you know, she's now coming into her house. So yeah, I just find that interesting. And then it makes me question too Nellie's perception of Linton and Heathcliff and Harriton, any other character, as we're seeing Kathy's character being perceived so differently than I imagine the other characters would be perceived differently from Zyla's perspective as opposed to Nellie's perspective.
I'm out running an errand. I don't have my microphone plugged in, so I hope the audio on this is going to be usable. Sam has a urology procedure coming up on Halloween, actually, and the doctor called me today, and he wanted, Sam has what's called colonized bacteria, so like if you do a urine test, it's always positive, and it's not normally treated unless he actually has symptoms of an infection, which he doesn't, but because he's going to be having a procedure, which is going to stir all that up, he's going to be more susceptible to that turning into an infection. So they want him to pre-medicate with these two different antibiotics before the procedure. And so I just went to go pick up the antibiotics, and I needed to get something from the urology clinic for his nurses at his rehab home where he is. And so I went into the clinic, and I talked to the clerk who I always deal with whenever we're there. And I actually, sadly, I don't know what her name is. But she recognized me right away, and we were just there last week. And she printed out what I needed, and then she came around her desk and she says, I just want to tell you from another veteran, she's a veteran, and I see you taking care of your husband, and just from another veteran, I want to thank you for taking care of one of my own. And she was teared up, and I teared up, and it was just, it was really sweet, very sincere gratitude from her. And she's saying, basically, you know, I'm looking for a relationship like you have, you know. I'm tearing up just talking about it. So it was just really special, and I think especially because so much of our interaction occurs online, whether it's because, you know, online shopping or self-check at the grocery store, there are so many things that where we've removed human contact from our everyday life, and that's really nice to just have a really human moment, and I don't mean this to be like braggadocious of like, oh, I'm so awesome, everybody thinks I'm awesome. Not at all. I'm just doing my thing, and sometimes just when you do your thing, you do you, be yourself, and you never know what kind of impact that's having on somebody else. So I just wanted to share that.
So it is Friday evening, about 7:15, and I'm home for the day. I'm in my comfy jammies. This is one of Sam's old t-shirts. And, oh, I finished Wuthering Heights this morning. So good. Oh, goodness. Hello. Yeah. I loved it. So, so good. I mean, I have basically zero recollection of reading it in high school. Right at my senior year of high school for English, and... yeah, I don't remember any of that, and you know, I wish I could have enjoyed it at the time, but it wasn't the time for me. So now is the time, and I really, really enjoyed it. I loved the symmetry of the story and how, you know, we have kind of the bookends of Mr. Lockwood. He appears, there's like, oh my gosh, hi. My hands are up, so my dog wants me to pet him. Stop talking with my hands. So anyway, the symmetry of Mr. Lockwood at the beginning and the end, kind of setting up Nellie's narration through the middle, and also the symmetry of having Heathcliff being kind of the odd man out, being taken care of by Mr. Earnshaw, and then having the son of... I'm blanking on his name right now, but the son of the Earnshaw boy, Catherine's brother, Harriton, ends up kind of being the Heathcliff of the next generation, and Heathcliff is kind of exacting out his revenge on basically everyone, on Hindley, that's his name, who's Harriton's father, because Hindley treated Heathcliff terribly, and so now Heathcliff treats Harriton terribly, and Harriton looks so much like his aunt Catherine, who Heathcliff was so in love with. And then we have the love story of the younger generation, and I really, really loved it. So that is that. And then this evening, Sam and I read at his place. I have a copy of... it's an illustrated Sherlock Holmes short story collection. So we read the Reigate mystery or something like that. So we read one short story, which was about 20 pages or so. And then, so Sam got to participate in some Victober. So maybe we'll keep dipping into that Sherlock book for the rest of the month. And then now, since... yeah, I finished Wuthering Heights. I need to pick a new read. So I have a few thoughts. So Frankenstein by Mary Shelley fits for both Victober and for Spookathon. And so does The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, which I think is only like 70 pages. And I really want to read. I haven't read any of my Reader's Digest classic editions yet. I would really like to read one of these. And then I'm also just kind of feeling The Bloody Chamber. So, I don't know. I might kind of pick at each of these tonight and see what I'm feeling and want to continue on with. So, I'll check in with you later. Maybe later tonight. Other than that, probably not till after my run tomorrow morning.